Good morning, everybody. That panel probably is going to be both broad, but we shall also try to make it more focused because of the time limitation we have. And let me share with you in the beginning some of the main concepts that have driven our interest in research, starting with Qatar Foundation, and then going across the whole country in order really to bring all the national stakeholders, whether in academia, industry, business community, in order really to make sure that we develop the right platform of the research enterprise in the whole country. When Education City has been developed, it was natural that we started with the degree granting programs, or in simpler terms, the educational component of the higher education enterprise in Qatar Foundation. In this respect, I would like to emphasize that although capacity building through education has been an important pillar, yet we have never thought of education being separate from research. And that's why the research model we opted to bring to Education City was actually what we call research education. And in essence, research education means that research is part of everything we do, even starting from freshman courses, going to the undergraduate program, and then the graduate programs, which are already starting to appear in our enterprise. It was also important to categorize what are the most important requisites for that human endeavor to be developed, continue to develop, and become deeply rooted in the organization. And in this respect, I'd like to say that through Qatar National Vision 2030, it became clear, actually, that we are going to deploy the revenues coming from the energy resource to support the transformation of the economy from energy-based economy into a knowledge-based one. In this concept, I would like to emphasize two important points, and these are quality and innovation. And that has been all the time the key messages and the key pillars we try to develop our research enterprise into. As you know, through education, you can convey knowledge, but in research, we have to generate knowledge. And I would like to reiterate once more how key and important that is for us. Probably, when we think about 10, 20 years from now, we would like to recognize what's happening in Qatar is the development of a hub of excellence that can contribute in the generation of knowledge. We depended on what at that time may have appeared as a new approach, but it is becoming now more prevalent, not only in our part of the world, but in other parts as well. We decided that we are not going to do this alone, and accordingly, the development of partnerships have been key in the master planning of the research enterprise we have today, starting with Education City and then going across the whole landscape of research in Qatar. Our strategic partners, which we see today in Education City, while Cornell Medical College, Texas A&M, Carnegie Mellon, Georgetown, Faculty of Islamic Studies, Northwestern, Virginia Commonwealth, and probably others coming in the future, are our starting point, and you can see clearly that they have been selected with a clear objective to bring to our part of the world some of the top research universities we know of today in the world. In this context, we thought that we should not only stop at that point. Immediately after we developed the degree granting programs, our next challenge was actually to reach not only to the national landscape and the regional landscape, but also to the international landscape. And we tried really to develop various models that can make what we are doing in Qatar as part of the international landscape of research in the whole world. It was evident that in order to do that, we have to develop two things: a clear strategy and a funding model. And our initial strategy has been developed around 2004 and has been updated recently in 2011. Our funding model, and you are going probably to hear more about that, is the Qatar National Research Foundation, which its funding arm is Qatar National Research Fund. We realized that there are three important pillars of success. human capital development to make the research enterprise sustainable for the long term. Operational excellence through best practices in management and operation of research, together with governance models that can bring the whole components or centers of excellence we are creating on the research enterprise together under one platform. And I'm going again to share with you how we have been able to do that. The third pillar has been our strategic clarity on defining what are our strategic themes in research, and this will be as in any other research enterprise in the world: biomedical research, energy and environment, computer sciences, social sciences, and humanities. But what is more important in that respect is to try to find an advantage and a relevance component that can bring these themes to the national and regional interests of Qatar and the region, and in the meantime, keeping a strong connection to fill in some of the gaps which are known or which are shared with other research enterprises from around the world. You are going to hear more about each of these, but I would like again to share with you the basic structures in the whole model. And I'll start with QNRF because it is the resource element of that enterprise which can take the mandate of that strategy and put it in implementation in order to direct our research funding in order to meet our research objectives. The second are Qatar research institutes. And these institutes, to date we have three of them: Qatar Biomedical Research Institute, Qatar Energy and Environment Research Institute, and Qatar Computing Research Institute. These institutes are acting as umbrella structures that embrace, overarch, all activities done in each of these fields together. And our hypothesis there is through these institutes, we will be able to integrate research done across the country, support more collaborations and synergies, optimize resources through enabling research technologies that can bring each of these themes on the right base and on the right start, and more so not to try to develop thick walls or boundaries between each of them, because as we know now, research is about becoming more about interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary research. Our partners, our intramural partners, these are the campuses of universities we have. Qatar University, Hamad Medical Corporation, ICT Qatar, and all these national stakeholders, each of them have their own centers. But these centers will come together with and not under the control of our Qatar research institutes. And in this way, we are addressing a very important challenge which we meet in our case with a limited number of researchers in each field. In this way, we are trying to develop a critical mass that can handle what we call grand challenges of research as identified in our research strategy and in our priorities program. I would like to say, before I end these remarks, that we believe that this is the beginning. And through media of this type and events of this type, through also some ingenuity models that we are trying to develop to increase our networking and our outreach to the world at large, we are hoping that gradually Qatar will become a hub of excellence for research, not only by the internal capacity we are trying to establish, but by feeling more and more that we are part of this globalized or globalization of research, which I would like to say that may have been not only one of the oldest examples of globalization, because all the time research has been globalized, but we are seeing much more of that because in technology development, easy outreach, and also because of the great partners we have and the great trust we have been able to establish between us, our internal partners, as well as our international partners. I would like to start by inviting members of each panel to the podium, but just one remark which may be some sort of arrangement that we, in order really to keep the time available on track, I hope that remarks given by each of the great members we have, we're going to see today on the panel, should actually not exceed between 3 to 4 minutes for each of them, in order really to be able to cover the various parts of our research strategy and the way we are going to implement it. Thank you very much.
شكرا دكتور سعود. والآن ستقسم الجلسة الأربع فقرات تناقش كل منها مجالا من المجالات التي تعالجها استراتيجية البحث في قطر. رحبوا معي أولا بالمشاركين الدائمين بالفقرات الثلاثة الأولى. السيد حمد الكواري نائب المدير العام لواحة قطر للعلوم والتكنولوجيا، فليتفضل. الدكتور عامر السعدي المستشار البحثي لمؤسسة قطر ومدير مشروع صندوق قطر لرعاية البحث العلمي. فتفضل. البروفيسور عبد الوهاب عروسي مدير مركز معالجة الغاز بجامعة قطر. فتفضل. يبدو أن البروفيسور عروسي ليس موجودا. تفضل. والمشاركين من الفقرة الأولى وهي بعنوان بحوث الطب الحيوي هم الدكتور عبد العالي الحوضي نائب الرئيس للبحوث بمؤسسة قطر والمدير الممثل لمعهد قطر لبحوث الطب الحيوي. الدكتور جافيد شيخ عميد كلية الطب وال كورنيل في قطر. فيتفضلوا مشكورين.
I would like actually to ask Dr. Abdelali probably to share with us the main priorities we have in the biomedical research enterprise.
Thank you, Dr. Fathy. You have just highlighted what are the main pillars of the research ecosystem in Qatar, where of course Qatar Foundation is an integral part of it, but also equally important how it is for us, whether the foundation or the whole country, the national strategy for research is important. It's also important to revise it each time we go further. I will start with the umbrella organization for biomedical research, that is the Qatar Biomedical Research Institute. The way we're organizing it, of course, collaboratively and in partnership with other national stakeholders and partners within Education City, is that we focus in a number of disease areas that are very relevant to the region, but also with global impact, and making it in a way where every single stakeholder can have an important role to play. With that, perhaps I think the next connection to that is to see how, in terms of training, building the capacity for biomedical research and linking with the clinical providers, how that is being achieved through our medical school at Weill Cornell Medical College.
Sure. Thank you, Dr. Abdelali. As Dr. Saoud very cogently described the national strategy, which really is to transform Qatar into a knowledge-based economy and build the research strategy in connection with that, so it is. They both of them go hand to hand in glove. While Cornell Medical College, our strategy focuses on, it's a two-pronged strategy. One is to bring in, to build local capacity by bringing in expertise. The way we have done that is by establishing research cores, several of them, the general research core, genomics core, proteomics core, bioinformatics core, stem cell research core, and bringing the expertise which runs those cores, bringing in researchers from all over the world. And the last four researchers that I brought in are from Harvard, Columbia, Cornell, Max Planck Institute. That is one prong of the strategy to build local capacity here. The second, equally important, but I would say probably even more important prong of the strategy is to really establish partnerships with our local partners. Starting with the Qatar Foundation, the research arm, Dr. Abdelali has been very supportive of us, and we always work together in terms of setting up individual research programs. But let me bring in the other partner that we are working with here. Very recently, we launched an academic health systems program in collaboration with our partners here, Hamad Medical Center, Sidra Medical and Research Center, Qatar University, University of Calgary Nursing, all of them coming together to establish a partnership to focus on certain research teams. So now let me take one specific example in the next minute or so to give the example of diabetes. The goal is to go from basic science, from bench side, to the bedside and all the way to the community. So Dr. Abdelali will be chairing a panel later on. What you have there is our partners, our colleagues, our faculty members at Weill Cornell Medical College. What we have, let me just give one example. We have Chris Triggle, who is focusing on basic mechanistic research in diabetes. Then we have Dr. Ziri, who is looking at the clinical population at Hamad Medical Center. Then we have our colleagues from New York who are focusing on doing certain kinds of bariatric surgery which can help with diabetes. We are also, with the help of Supreme Council of Health, establishing a robust epidemiological program which looks at how common diabetes is, and when we establish new strategies, therapeutic strategies after our research, how do we convey that to the populace? And we are working on that. So it will be benchside to bedside to community. That is just an example. Another one would be neuroscience, but my time is up, so I would not go into that. But thank you. Really, the goal is to produce capacity, bring the partners together, and then take the message to the community. Thank you.
And really to make sure, again, that is that when we say we're we're covering all the spectrum or continuum of research, it's not just a plan, it's not just a strategy, but it's truly a reality. And then we have the Qatar Science and Technology Park that truly is the home for the more applied technology development research.
Sure. So in terms of the application, the other thing which we are doing here is to really train the students here, particularly local Qatari students from Qatar University and other institutions who spend time in our laboratories, learn about research, then they are prepared to go abroad, get their PhDs, come back and become leaders in research. That is one example. I know the same thing is happening at Hamad, our colleagues. They are working very closely with multiple institutions to train both their physicians as well as nurses to get them further training to prepare them for the culture of research.
So the hub for that, for the applied research at Science and Technology Park.
I think to highlight what the activities that are undertaken by Qatar Science Technology Park, I mean, the mission of QSTP is to be an international, recognized international hub for research, applied research and innovation and entrepreneurship. In the pillar of health and sciences, we do have in QSTP at the robotic surgery training center, which we are training some of the surgeons in Hamad Medical Corporation at QSTP facility. We have other projects and a platform available for monitoring health, such as a project that we developed with Aspitar, which is called RASAD. Those type of projects that QSTP are working on are definitely at the end of the supply chain, which is the commercialization aspect, looking at projects to that, you know, how can we take the idea, the pattern, the proof of concept, prove it, commercialize it, and actually get it to the people where they can benefit from.
I think it is important for us also to know a little bit more about the funding model that made that strategy, as well as the priorities program, really operate in terms of achieving eventually our objectives in the research enterprise. And I think yes. Dr. Amer can comment on that.
Thank you, Dr. Fathy. Qatar National Research Fund was established in 2006 exactly for the reason that Dr. Fathy outlined earlier. The skeleton he sketched is quite relevant and comprehensive, but if you'd like to know more about the activities of the various activities, exciting activities and promising activities, and the research funding across the educational ladder from secondary schools all the way up to postdocs, and then please attend the next session, which will be devoted fully for the Qatar National Research Fund. The model of funding we adopted was to start with the easiest for us at the time, is the undergraduate research experience program. This came timely when the universities and education city were ready for it. They have several stages of education already behind them. And also Qatar University, who have turned its attention to research, was a prime receiver of the grants that we give. So we are facilitators, educated facilitators, who research funding on competitive basis, peer-reviewed research. Thank you.
I believe actually that it's very important to hear the role of Qatar University in the whole of that research enterprise. Qatar University, as all of us know, and for other members of the forum who are coming here for the first time, is the national university. It has got the largest number of students enrolled in degree-granting programs. It started more than 35 years ago now. And we couldn't actually work on that strategy and see it implementable without bringing the most important national partner for that research enterprise. They have the largest number of students, as I have mentioned, and in the area of biomedicine, and I hope Professor Arousi is going to mention something about this. They have got a great story that started sometime at the late 80s when their first biomedical sciences program was created. And that program has been one of the most successful programs in Qatar University, and it is actually feeding most of our research capacity in biomedical sciences today. So please go ahead, Professor Arousi.
Thank you very much. And first of all, we're delighted to be here. And for Qatar University as a national university, as stated by my colleagues in the podium, we have a strategy of evaluating where we are on a regular basis. So we do a regular appraisal with a reality check of the situation in Qatar in terms of the playing field. So we regularly appraise. We try to build on the existing capacity in Qatar, that is within the university, within all the operators and stakeholders in the nation. And we try to embrace new goals. These goals are designed to meet the 2030 vision of the nation. So consequently, we have like a loop that we in the university, with all the entities within the university and with our partners who are industrialists, government agency, international partners from the podium and around the room. And what we try to do at the end of the day is to deliver a national university that meets the vision. And as stated, the biomedical activities have been going on in the university for a long time and have been feeding different stakeholders in the country with good researchers and good scientists and medical trained people. But more importantly now, we realize that we are operating in a global arena, so consequently we are creating centers for excellence, not of excellence yet, but we hope soon we will be centers of excellence, in partnership with our industrial partners, as I said, with all the stakeholders, government agency, within and Qatar, in the region, as well as the international sphere, and to try and meet the Qatarization targets as well. So therefore, we are embracing these new targets. We are adjusting ourselves in terms of building the physical capacity, the human capacity, and delivering on the goals. And I hope that through the presentation that I shall be giving later on, through the partnership that we are building, you'll have a feel that in Qatar University, what you have is a partner of choice that will go hand in hand with all the other entities within the nation to deliver on the 2030 vision.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arosi. I think probably with what Dr. Arosi has elaborated on, this will end the first part of the research strategy. And I'd like to thank you. And I'd like to thank Dr. Sheikh. And let us go into the next one. Thank you. Thank you very much.
شكرا للمتحدثين. والآن ننتقل إلى الفقرة الثانية بعنوان بحوث البيئة والطاقة والمتحدثين هم لورد روبرت ريجديل المتحدث باسم الديمقراطيين الليبراليين عن الطاقة والبيئة والزراعة مجلس اللوردات المملكة المتحدة فليتفضل. الدكتور مارك وايكهول عميد جامعة تكساس اي ان ام بقطر فليتفضل. الدكتور ربيع مختار مدير معهد قطر للبحوث البيئة والطاقة فليتفضل.
I hope all of us will agree and appreciate that energy is at the heart of many things we do because it is our main source of support, our main source of outreach activities which we do, and that's why we believe that the Qatar National Energy or Qatar Energy and Environment Research Institute plays a very important role in the management and operation implementation of our Qatar National Research Strategy. And I would like to ask Dr. Rabia, being leading that institute to date, really to moderate that discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Saoud, and thank you for the opportunity to share with you the Qatar National Research Strategy for the Environment and Energy. As Dr. Saoud mentioned, energy and energy resources is very critical in its all forms to Qatar and for the region. And the strategy has been guided by the Qatar National Vision 2030. The research priorities for the Qatar National Research Priorities in the energy and environment can be categorized into four different areas. Solar energy being the first, hydrocarbon and natural gas technologies, second, energy, water, food nexus, which is very critical in this time for us in Qatar and in the region because of the resource scarcity. Last but not least is the water research. In the solar energy, we at the moment have the part of the strategy focusing on the assessing the solar resources, so developing a solar maps and looking into solar electricity and its application to desalination, something that we will be considering in the future, identified by the Qatar National Research Strategy, is the solar to chemical technologies. In the hydrocarbon and natural gas technologies, we're looking into purification and conversion of natural gas. We're looking at core hydrocarbon research in partnership to be done with Qatar Petrol and its subsidiaries, and looking at carbon dioxide capture. Another area for the future to be considered that has been recommended by the strategy is the discovery of new materials, which is also being under consideration with some of our partners. In the energy water food nexus, which is actually at the core of the sustainability, looking at energy and its interface, interlinkages with the water security and with the food security that Qatar has moved forward with, we're looking at biodiversity and environmental restoration of desert and Gulf ecosystem. We're looking at modeling of the desert environment and food security. In the water area, as I mentioned earlier, we're looking at desalination that is powered by the solar and renewable energy, and we're also looking at water conservation and reuse. The way the strategy will be implemented is looking into our research community internally and externally. So within Qatar Foundation and within Qatar, Hamad bin Khalifa University and the branch campuses will play a huge role, as Dr. Saoud mentioned earlier. We're looking at partnership with already a moving partnership with Qatar University and with the College of North Atlantic. And last but not least is the oil and gas industry led by QP and its subsidiary in terms of the gas technologies. As far as our stakeholders that will help achieve those national research strategies, we're looking at the Ministry of Environment, Ministry of Energy, and Ministry of Health, and the Qatar National Food Security Program. We have also regional partnership that we are building, because as was indicated earlier in the discussion, that the regional partnership is very, very key. The problems of energy and environment security in this in Qatar is not unique. It's shared by the entire region. And with the globalization, with the theme of today, we really have no choice but to look into regional and international partners to help us achieve those research goals. Thank you.
I think I am personally honored and delighted to see here with us today Lord Ridsdale, and I would like really him to share with us in his capacity actually as a great leader that has been engaged in that theme for a number of years, his views about the future of globalized collaborations in this very, very important area.
Thank you very much. In the spirit of research, I'll ask three questions of the audience. Don't answer, just think about them. First is, what is the carbon impact of every email you send? The second question is, how many emails do each of us have on our inbox? And the third question is, has anybody actually thought that there was a carbon impact of the emails they sent? I'll just go through those. It's been worked out that an email with an attachment over its lifetime sitting on servers is about 4 grams of carbon. Now, each of you is then going to have to work out how many emails you've got and how you personally are destroying the planet, because researchers seem to have anywhere between a few hundred thousand and millions of emails each. It doesn't matter if you delete them, because they're on backed up on other areas. And of course, the problem is the third point. So many people you ask go, I never knew there was a cost to it. It's even worse if you do a Google search to try and work out if I'm telling you the truth or not, because that's the equivalent of boiling a kettle. Just don't ask me how large the kettle is. It's all about working out and understanding our impact on the environment, and understanding and researching that so we can bring about behavior change. What I've been really amazed about is the openness of the institutes over here to look at researching this area. QCRI is looking at developing tools that can be used around the world for people to understand on an individual basis the effect they're having, not just on their computer, but on the computers, the servers that are actually being used to make that possible. QEERI is also looking at carbon management, and there's a conference on carbon management. Behavior change is going to be one of the really, really tough areas of research to crack, because 50% of all carbon saving comes about from behavior change. So on that basis, I think really, because carbon is actually bringing about climate change, this collaboration between the Institute and the work of the Qatar Foundation could have literally a global impact on the rate of climate change through the reduction of carbon use in computings. That is, and computing. That is really, I think, following on the idea of where research should be going.
Thank you very much, Lord Ridsdale. And I think you indicated clearly why both energy and environment should be really looked at
at a very balanced way, and we are trying to do that. I would like actually to invite Dean Mark Weichold, Dean of Texas A&M in Qatar. And before I give him actually the floor to speak about what role Texas A&M is playing in that strategy, I would like to say that Texas A&M, being an important leader of higher education and research in petroleum engineering, together with another set of engineering disciplines, has been key and one of our top priorities when we started programs in Education City. And we were lucky because, as all of us know, they are ranked as number one institution in petroleum engineering in North America. The most important clear role that Texas A&M has been doing, and they are leading that type of approach, is their relationship with the industry. Texas A&M has been able to establish immediately after they came to Qatar an excellent rapport and an excellent connection with the industry, the national industry leader of the energy sector, and that is Qatar Petroleum. And they are also having the Minister of Energy, His Excellency Mohammed Sada, who was talking to us yesterday, as the chair of their advisory board. And I believe actually that Texas A&M is setting a model for research partnerships that puts a lot of attention to the core partner in the energy sector in Qatar, and with their experience in establishing similar partnerships with top corporate organizations from around the world, I think they can provide us a role model that can lead many of our research strategies and our research effort. Please go ahead, Dr. White.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fathy, and thank you very much for the very kind remarks that you just shared regarding Texas A&M University. As Dr. Fathy indicated, Texas A&M offers engineering programs. In addition to petroleum engineering, we offer programs in chemical, electrical, and mechanical engineering. But since we have to offer the entire curricula for those four programs, we also have very talented chemists, mathematicians, and physicists. One of the core components of our research program is that the research is faculty-driven. These programs result through a process of competitive, peer-reviewed research proposals. Common throughout all of these programs, we want to emphasize, as was a theme in Dr. Fathy's comments, the relevance of the research to the state of Qatar. In doing so, we engage, of course, Qatar Foundation, but QSTP, the QNRF, and now more recently with the advent of the Qatar Energy and Environment Research Institute, they are also one of our partners. We work very hard to be collaborative in nature. We have research partnerships with our sister campuses in Education City, with Qatar University, but also around the world. We engage in research activities that support the ministries here in Qatar, but also, very importantly, about 20% of our research funding comes from industry, as Dr. Fathy indicated. Outcomes, of course, we're engaged in research to generate new knowledge, but to also focus that new knowledge to produce solution to local opportunities. Many of our research activities have begun to appear now in commercial operations, and we feel that's a very important contribution that we can make to the move toward a knowledge-based economy. Since this portion of the panel deals with energy and environment, I'll share a little bit with you about the details, but keep in mind we are very broad-based in our research endeavors. In terms of energy, we're engaged in GTL research with Shell. This is the gas to liquids that produces diesel or jet fuel from the methane. We're looking at oil and gas production, including enhanced oil recovery, acidation, and so forth. We're looking with our electrical engineering program at the energy production, distribution, and efficiency. And also, very importantly, we're looking at safety research. In particular, I draw attention to the research that we're engaged in, looking at how one deals with the spillage of liquefied natural gas. In terms of environment, we're looking at water-related research, including desalination processes, the production, reuse, and distribution of water, air quality. And while this may not be immediately apparent, we are also very much involved in the state of Qatar's food security efforts. We see all of this as being very key in developing human capacity here through our undergraduate research programs, as you heard earlier, through our graduate program, postdoctoral research, and our young scientists that we develop through these mechanisms. We feel very flattered to be part of a vibrant, dynamic research environment that we have here in the state of Qatar. And as I indicated, we have very productive researchers. We've got 10 invention disclosures, one of which is nearing commercialization. We appreciate the opportunity to be part of this. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Weichold. QSTP actually is playing a key role, really, in our R&D in the area of energy and environment. And I would like Hamad Al-Kawari really to probably, in a nutshell, approach, because you are, what you are doing is great there. You have over 20 or more companies who are doing their research and development in QSTP, and some of the great leaders of that corporate research and development are already in your park. So please try to share with our great audience today what QSTP is doing in that respect.
On the energy and environment pillar, I mean, approximately half of the members of QSTP are working on energy and environment. The major IOCs, the international oil and gas companies, Qatar Petroleum as the national oil and gas company. So if you take the first pillar, which is energy, the three sub-themes of that pillar is the strategic assets of the country. This is a country that, you know, has its wealth from oil and gas. Oil and gas is staying for a long time. So we established a project, you know, on that on the area of geosciences and CO2 capturing with the national oil and gas company, Qatar Petroleum, Shell, and an academic partner, which is an Imperial College. On the second sub-theme of energy is solar energy and alternative energy, more general. Our focus there, specifically on solar, we're establishing, which is actually under construction now, the solar demonstrator, where we are going to be testing with our partners, Green Gulf, which is a startup company, which the CEO gave a presentation on entrepreneurship on the first day, and our other partners, Chevron Energy Solutions. The solar demonstrator will be testing the technologies available around the world, which is approximately 25 companies now, only in phase one, which is the photovoltaic. Then we'll be establishing the second phase with regards to thermal technologies, solar cooling, solar parabolic troughs, and those type of technologies to see which ones are really applicable to this country. The third sub-theme of energy is related to the oil and gas derivatives, the commodities that's available in the country itself, and what other technologies can we bring into the country and commercialize in a way to add value to those commodities that are not really used efficiently right now. On the pillar of environment, the focus in QSTP is definitely water. Like Dr. Rabia mentioned, water is definitely an important element, an important commodity to the country. 99.9% of the water in Doha is desalinated. So coming up with finding other technologies to do desalination, either through solar or other alternative methods where you decouple it from the production of electricity, because that's how the water is produced now in Qatar. At the same time, we're looking at a project, or we have a project launched with, like Dr. Bark mentioned, with the GTL, with Shell, and Texas A&M, and other, consortium of partners, where we look at the use of GTL in aviation, and how can this help, the local environment of airports with regards to the emissions. Another sub-theme of environment is the use of biofuel into the aviation. We have a partnership with Qatar University and Qatar Airways, looking at solutions to find have the BTL actually certified, and what can we do in the state of Qatar with regards. We have other members in QSTP who are working on environment, such as Total, who's working on air monitoring technologies and predictive models to the environment. So we have quite a few, like Dr. Fathy mentioned, we have the projects what QSTP are involved in, around 21 projects that we're directly involved. Then you have the other tenants or members in QSTP who are doing their own applied research, which is all the major IOCs that's actually available in the country.
Thank you very much, Hamad. I think Hamad is showing clearly a little bit more on what I was mentioning. We are trying really to benefit from the great opportunity and margin we have in QSTP. There are many, probably, or number of QSTPs in the region, but none of them are so aligned and integrated with the academic institutions we have on the academia side. And this will work in their direction. Another important direction is the clear alignment QSTP is trying to get with the industry and the business community. And this could have never happened by chance. It needed a lot of planning, it needed a lot of good work in order really to earn the respect and trust of these other partners. And that's what QSTP has been trying to do. I would like actually again to ask Dr. Arousi. He is now wearing a number of hats when he came from Qatar University, and I hope you can actually also, because of your engineering school at Qatar University, as well as some of your interest in the gas center at Qatar University, please go ahead and give us your comments there.
Thank you very much. As a university, it's very unfair to try in a few minutes to give you a summary of what we do, like my colleague from Texas A&M, and indeed from QSTP. We are engaged in numerous activities. But as a national university, we have concentrated on the national priorities. The national priorities, and Professor Smalley, who won the Nobel Prize, I think, in 1996, was asked in 2003 to name the 10 most challenging issues for humanity over the next 50 years, and he nominated water, energy, environment, and food. So therefore, if you add these four together, you have the sustainability issue, which we, as a national university, we have to address. And consequently, we have centers for excellence. We have a Center for Environmental Studies, which is a national leader in marine science. And now it's increasing its scope to cover for soil, for air, like what you heard from Texas A&M, looking at air quality, looking at the issues, the carbon footprint that we're talking about. I didn't realize the email was that. I'm going to go back to the abacus. And we have now invested as a university heavily in the Environmental Studies Center. We have a new marine vessel to add to the existing one. We have a new marine station. We are investing in human capacity. We would like that center to be not just the regional leader, but to be the international leader that people can come to, not only from within the region, but also from around the globe for advice and so on. And please go to the website and you see what we're doing. Before I go to my center, I will also say that we have developed programs such as Environmental Engineering Master Program. We're now engaged in doctoral training programs, deliberately to try and meet the challenge of fishing in a small pool of people, which is the problem with Qatar, you know, the population, but also to address, as I said, the national priority issues. On the gas center, we work with a very healthy consortium of 16 oil and gas companies, the Ministry of Environment, and we do a Taguchi, look at the critical issues that need to be investigated. And for the gas industry in Qatar, there are some common issues, such as issues of hydrate formation in pipes, the carbon management or carbon mitigation. Storage in Qatar is probably out of the question, so we're looking at other issues. How can we recycle the captured carbon? We're looking at, for example, sour gas treatment. We're looking for the produced water, because the gas industry has a lot of produced water. And we're trying to develop, in collaboration with the Qatar Green Building Council, alliances between, say, the construction industry and the gas industry, so that we can meet the needs that a surplus of one industry is the prime need for another industry. As such, because when you think of the gas industry, you have pipelines, you have plants, and so on. So we have a material technology unit that deals exactly with that issue, the issue of sea line pipelines, such as corrosion, and so on. So as a university, we are trying to invest, to nurture talent, to recruit strategically when necessary, to partner strategically when necessary, in order to meet the challenge. What we don't want to happen in Qatar is for Qatar to remain as a turnkey industry. In other words, you buy everything ready-made and you just turn it on. We would like us to have the knowledge, which is, after all, the vision of moving from a hydrocarbon economy to a knowledge-based economy.
Thank you very much, Dr. Arousi. Probably I'll comment a little bit more in the wrap-up at the end. And I would like really to thank Dr. Weichold, Lord Ridsdale, as well as Dr. Rabia. And I would like to invite to the podium our next panelists from the computer science research theme. Thank you. Thank you.
شكرا للمتحدثين. والآن فليتفضل المتحدثون عن بحوث الحوسبة. الدكتورة روزينا باكشي مديرة مركز بحوث تكنولوجيا المعلومات سترس. الدكتور أحمد المقرمد مدير معهد قطر لبحوث الحوسبة فليتفضل. الدكتور مجد صقر العميد المساعد لشؤون البحث في جامعة كارنيجي ميلون في قطر فليتفضل.
This has been a very important area as in the case of engineering. It was among our top priorities when we created the Education City Master Plan. As our strategic partner, we have one of the top universities in United States, Carnegie Mellon University, which is ranked among the top best in that, best five in that field, and they are number one in a number of other specialties related to that field. And we have Dr. Ahmed now, who is leading the Qatar Computer Science Research Institute, and I'm really glad to see here you, Dr. Huzina. And I'd like to ask Dr. Ahmed really to give us an outline of the main strategy objectives he and his team are trying to fulfill in that area.
Thank you, Dr. Fathy. the Qatar Computing Research Institute is focused on a research mission that is broad, but takes its roots at the needs of Qatari society. The research institutes, being a national research resource, in QCRI, we are focused on working with the stakeholders in building a national research infrastructure. As some of you may have seen when we announced MADAD, MADAD is an example of a national research infrastructure that is focused on the enablement of science and engineering discovery.
Thank you very much, Dr. Ahmed. And I'd like to invite Dr. Rosina Bakshi, who is serving actually on the Qatar Computer Science Research Institute Advisory Board, which actually leads the think tank approach we are using with many of these institutes. So please, I hope you can share with us your thoughts about what is going on in that area.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It has been a really eye-opener to be here and a real pleasure. I will try to share with you my experience from 2001 when I became a founding director of a center called CITRUS, Center for Information Technology in Service to Society. This was a center established at University of California between four campuses. Berkeley was the lead, and I became the founding director. The approach I took was that information technology is a glue and on a substantive level to serve, to advance the information technology, but also benefit to all the other sciences. So to my mind, the QCRI and the cloud computing and the infrastructure that they are creating is really a golden opportunity for Qatar becoming a real hub for this knowledge-based technology that would combine the data coming from the biomedical research. I already heard that you folks are collecting data from the obesity people and the other problems, and also the environmentalists have a project of managing the air pollution. You have sensors all around Qatar that you are collecting data. All this data needs to be stored, needs to be analyzed, needs to be visualized, and QCRI has all the opportunity and capability to do so. Now, finally, I like to say one more thing, that what I did when I became a director, I also reached out to humanities and started what became the word digital humanities. And there is, again, a golden opportunity for QCRI becoming a center of promoting the Islamic culture in digital form, in displaying your heritage, your history, and all the cultural wealth in the digital form, and thereby make it accessible to the rest of the world. Finally, if you allow me to say, as a senior woman in computer science, I really want to welcome all the Qatari female students that I saw in action. They are terrific, and I am excited to see so many of them. Keep going.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. I would like to invite Dr. Majd Sakr, who is the Assistant Dean of Research in Carnegie Mellon, to share with us the role of Carnegie Mellon in the computer science research arena. Please go ahead, Dr. Majd.
Thank you, Dr. Saoud. On behalf of Dean Baybars, I'd like to thank you for giving us this opportunity to participate and share our views. For your benefit, Carnegie Mellon offers four programs in Qatar: computer science, information systems, business administration, and more recently, biological sciences and computational biology. And we believe that at the heart of education lies research, and that's how we can prepare the next generation moving forward. Carnegie Mellon believes that the research that should be carried out should be bold, interdisciplinary, and impactful for this region. We are part of this region as Carnegie Mellon Qatar, and we like to exercise this philosophy that we adopt. So with that, we collaborate with universities all around the world, about 182, as well as inside Qatar, Qatar University, Hamad Medical Center, Weill Cornell, Texas A&M, more recently the research institutes that are recently established. So the research that we do should be regional and should be aligned with Qatar's needs. We should have the impact be also focused on what the region needs as well. With the benefit of the research that we continue to receive from the Qatar Foundation and the Qatar National Research Fund, we have recently developed our research capacity quite significantly, and we will continue to do so moving forward, specifically in the following areas that are relevant to the discussion that we are having here. So we have Professor Oflazer working with his team on Arabic language technologies and automatic translation of Wikipedia documents, as well as automatic correction of automatic translation, spelling errors and what have you. We have my team working on cloud computing. This has been developing a cloud infrastructure to enable scientists to run their models and simulations on and take advantage of what the cloud infrastructure has to offer. This has been in collaboration with both Qatar University and Texas A&M, a very healthy collaboration. And more recently, we're discussing a larger, more public initiative with QCRI that would increase the capacity of what we offer. With respect to applied robotics, we have Professor Browning and Dias working on developing robots that inspect gas pipelines, and they're working closely with ExxonMobil, RasGas, and Qatar Petroleum. And this is applied robotics for oil and gas, for industry, as well as for the environment. Security is extremely important, especially for a country like Qatar, and we're focusing primarily on web security. So we have Professor Cervasato and Sanz. They're working closely with entities within Qatar to develop this activity as well. Networking, needless to say, needs to happen, and wireless mobile networking protocols, algorithms. Our information systems faculty are working on information systems for health systems, as well as on developing e-tutors. Our computer science faculty are developing intelligent tutors that customize the content and the method of delivering the content to to how students learn right here. We also are delighted about the computational biology program coming up to speed really soon, and we are hoping to collaborate with the institutes as well as with Hamad Medical Center and Weill Cornell on this. It's important that we do all of this research and focus on areas that are relevant to Qatar, but it's also to try as best as we can to collaborate with both government and industry. And in that regards, we have been working with the Ministry of Interior on forensics and security, and we're putting together a conference this March, which will invite experts from all around the world, and we invite those of you who are interested to participate. We're also in very strong ties with the GSDP, the General Secretariat for Development and Planning in Qatar, the folks who have put the Qatar National Vision 2030 in developing entrepreneurship training programs and other. And with the Qatar 2022 Council as well, and in areas in which Carnegie Mellon can be productive, as well as Qatar Petroleum and other. So this is with respect to within Qatar, and we also are working regionally so that we can make the region a place for star computer scientists to consider as a place where they can grow their careers and blossom. And that requires that the entire region participates and we collaborate hand in hand.
Thank you very much, Dr. Majd. I would like to thank you, Dr. Ahmed, Rosina, and Majd. And thank you very, very much for your thoughtful remarks there.
Great.
Thank you.
شكرا لكم. واخيرا وليس اخرا نقدم المشاركين في الفقره الخاصه ببحوث الفنون والعلوم الاسلاميه الانسانيه عفوا. الدكتور حاتم قرنشاوي عميد كليه قطر الدراسات الاسلاميه. تفضل. جيرد نونمان عميد جامعه جورجتاون في قطر فيتفضل. أليسون فانستون عميد جامعة فيرجينيا كومنولث في قطر فيتفضل. تفضل عفوا. أفرت دينيس عميد جامعة نورث ويسترن في قطر فيتفضل. شكرا.
I would like to share with you again, with all transparency and objectivity. In the beginning of the whole project, we have been all the time talking and focusing more and more on science and technology. But it was very clear that we cannot really reach our objectives by only focusing on these areas, because in the whole human endeavor to develop any of these areas, there is a humanities social sciences component that need to be addressed. And I'd like to say that it became very clear to us that we really have to invest in these areas. And our first partner there was Virginia Commonwealth University, when they started offering their design arts program through a school at that time used to be called the School of Design Arts, SCODA. But after we developed the campus model, they became a fully renowned campus in Education City, and we are proud, very proud of the contribution that campus has actually given to the whole of our enterprise. They started only offering programs for females, but now they are offering it more also for males. And I'd like to start really with Dean Vanston to speak about their role actually in leading the social sciences and humanities part of research in Education City.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fathy. It's a pleasure to be here. And to speak first in this distinguished panel of colleagues. I'd like to just reference two comments from the last two panels, the one about sending our messages and emails and instant messaging and information like that is so important for designers and artists to be aware of, because they take those new thoughts and may translate and think about them and then project them back out into society so people have access to that type of knowledge to possibly then change their habits and practices. And the other comment about computer information in relationship to the humanities and the organization that was created around that, the consideration of how computers relate and the systems that relate back to how people engage daily is really where designers and artists find their place in the conversation and research. So just taking those two comments as a point of departure, we had a science fiction writer last week at our school, Bruce Sterling, who spoke about artists and designers out there currently that are having a probe, and they said, okay, we've created a product now that will deliver your instant message in 6 months. So when that happens, how do we rethink what it means to send our instant message and why it's so important that we have these constant instant messages and emails? So designers and artists work in this unique space where they can take and relate and engage with what's happening around the world and reform questions, think about how we're all practicing and participating, and then come up with challenges, probes, questions, solutions, ideas that may lead to a new thinking about our collaborative future together. So that's how, as Virginia Commonwealth University in Qatar, we look at our research, overall research emphasis. From our faculty developing their research practice and what they're interested in and engaged in, to our students and their undergraduate research projects. We've taken full advantage of the undergraduate research experience, the national priorities funding. We've been funded by QSTP to do an engagement where we're just coming to a prototype stage of new migrant worker labor housing that we hope through QSTP and the new initiative of Design Zone will become a fully developed commercialized product that will go into production and change workers' lives in the entire region would be our hope. And those are just some basic ideas on where we're at.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I would like again to refer the discussion to Dr. Gerd Nonneman, who has been recently appointed as to lead the Georgetown University in Qatar, who have been with us actually since 2005. And as all of us know, this is, if not the top school of international affairs in the United States, it is among the top couple of or three. But I believe they are number one. And we are really very glad, really, to see Dr. Nonneman there, because the landscape of research in international affairs is becoming wider in the world that we live today. And I would like, actually, to ask him to comment, actually, on the role of the campus in promoting research in this particular theme.
Thank you, Mr. Fathy.
So thank you, Dr. Fathy. And I won't contradict you on the number one. I'll take that. It's a pleasure to be here and to be in Qatar, actually, to be integrating. Although I've been coming to Qatar on and off for the last 15 years, it's quite different to actually be able to live here and really integrate with what goes on. And I think that's also one of my key themes for how I see the role of Georgetown in Qatar. It is integration. It's integration at a number of levels. Integration, first of all, of research with teaching. In other words, move to the next phase, and I'll come back to that in a second. Do not, and I think this is a general message, we do not want to segregate research off into a separate corner. The second is integration within Hamad bin Khalifa University and other institutions. There are obvious synergies to be had with other institutions in Education City, but also very particularly, I think, with Qatar University. That's important for two reasons. One, because of the obvious potential synergies, but secondly, because, as you said earlier in your remarks, Dr. Fathy, Qatar University is the big national university. Now, I've got the personal benefit of having long had a number of personal relationships with people at doing research at Qatar University, but this is one of my key aims, really. In fact, I came here this morning from a major conference at Qatar University, and I shall be going back there afterwards for some of the day. And if the third element of integration is integration with a wider society, both in all of our sort of operations, but also specifically in how we develop our research focus. Now, it's fairly well, of course, to say, yes, we want research to be relevant. We want people to recognize what we do and why we do it. I want that to be translated as engaging with stakeholders in Qatari society, institutions from the NGO sector to business to government, to make clear that we are interested in their views, their needs, and so on. But that does not equate to saying only research what those interlocutors would like. I mean, that there are two parts to this. And in part, that relates to two other things. There are one specific to Georgetown and one related to the title of this session. The one related to Georgetown is Georgetown, of course, was brought in not just as an international affairs operation, but to deliver a liberal arts curriculum. A liberal arts in the American sense is something where you provide students with a very broad range of skills, of insights, from history to economics, to languages and international affairs, social sciences in the broad sense, and then build on that to give them a top-class education in international affairs. We've got three majors: international economics, culture and politics, and international politics. Now, the nature of a curriculum like that and the kinds of people you want to attract to teach that while integrating research means that by definition one's going to conduct research that relates to that sort of curriculum, to those, that sort of spread of interests. The second reason, the second point I was going to link this to is the title of the session, globalization. To my mind, there are several kinds of relevance to Qatar. One is the immediately visible, practically applicable type of relevance. But the other, and one might argue at least as important, if not more important, is the relevance that lies in being globally excellent and globally visible. In other words, you undertake research that's globally excellent and globally visible, then that's perhaps the best kind of relevance one can think of. Now, to go back to Dr. Fathy's early remarks, it is true, clearly Georgetown, as much as many of the other institutions, when we first arrived, it was all about delivering the curriculum. That was the assumption, that's how resources were put in place, that's how structures were designed. Now, we are moving into a new phase. There's no question about it. It's under pressure of our own faculty, it's under pressure from society, it's under pressure from and the demand of Qatar Foundation itself, and rightly so. Now, that requires retooling, reorganizing, reallocating resources, building further resources, because it really is creating or making research the fully joint second mission alongside the teaching of the curriculum. So we are now reorganizing to make this possible. We will be building faculty to create the kind of robustness that you need to create the one thing that in the social sciences and humanities in short supply, it's not money, it's time for these people to do that work. So that is something that's now absolutely at the heart of my plans, of our plans. What kind of research do we then do? Well, it's already producing globally relevant stuff, ranging across history to international law, aspects of international economics, including also economics specifically on the Qatari and Gulf economies. Also, aspects of Islam from a social science perspective, linking into a couple of things that were said earlier, for instance, digitalization. We have a strong interest in that direction and are working towards a project, or have been engaged in a project and will be working towards continuation of that in the specific theme of bioethics in Islam. This Arabic, not simply as a teaching approach, but the whole question of how one teaches Arabic for so-called heritage learners, of students who are from an Arabic background but do not necessarily pick up the kind of professional style, professional level Arabic. That's a different kind of teaching of the language. There's research to be done about this, and that goes on at Georgetown. Final point. Some of you, many of you, I'm sure, will have heard of CIRS, the Center for International and Regional Studies, which has been putting on regular high-profile events on issues of politics, economics, international affairs, security, and so on. CIRS is part and parcel of Georgetown. That is where the most visible research used to be located, although they had a very specific brief. It's things to do about the region and the economics, the politics, and the international relations of that region. Other faculty have been doing lots of research on related or different fields for a long time. What was now happening is we're integrating that all much more effectively. And I'll keep it at that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gerd. At the heart and at the cornerstone of many things we do in social sciences and humanities is our Faculty of Islamic Studies. That program, or the sets of programs the faculty is actually delivering, is quite unique. We couldn't actually bring Islamic studies in the context of legacy institutions who have been there for hundreds of years. But as all of us know, that Muslim societies today are facing and meeting lots of challenges, not only related to their internal affairs, but also the way in which they, Islam and Muslims, are introduced to others. And I would like to ask Dean Hatem Karanshawy, who is leading, he is the founding dean, actually, of the Faculty of Islamic Studies, and unlike many of the other programs which we created, this is what I can call a homegrown faculty that has been established with the support and advice of global members from around the four corners of the world. So please go ahead, Professor Karanshawy.
Thank you, Dr. Fathy, and again, in the few minutes available, I may start with our mission. That's our mission is to engage with the world, not to separate from it. All of us know about the challenges facing Muslims today, domestically and internationally, whether it's about perception about themselves or the world perception about them. As such, and as a postgraduate school, we started from day one with the academic programs as well as the research centers. So research was an integral part of our work. And as a matter of fact, to develop our new programs, we had to indulge into a very extensive and a deep research. And if all of us, I hope, agree that science has no nationality, I believe that technology is an organic thing. It has to develop within a society, its values, its culture, its terms of reference. Then it can be. Products can be transferred to the rest of the world and benefited from. And from this point, again, and as we believe, as Islam teaches us to be civilization builders, and in the same time instructs us to seek knowledge and to engage with the world, that from the very beginning, we started our collaboration with the others, with the hope to enlighten ourselves first and the world about the true values of Islam, and at the same time, to make sure that whatever developments that takes place would be suitable for our part of the world, for the rest of the world, Muslim world, and as such, being so much adaptable to us, its products and outcomes can be exported and benefit the rest of the humanity as a whole. We, if again, in front of me, Dr. Mark of Texas, values of work and how it affects engineering with a joint activity, research activity with Texas A&M, is bioethics with Georgetown University. We are working with it. We are investigating the frontiers of urban design and architecture in Muslim societies with Virginia and Commonwealth. We are already submitting a request for QNRF for the development of a thorough study of Islam in West Africa and its connection with the migration to North America and South America with our colleagues from Northwestern and from our colleagues from Carnegie Mellon. And this is just an example of the kind of thing that we try to work to fulfill our own mission. In the meantime, within the Qatari society, we are deeply involved in various activities, including research with Qatar Central Bank, with Qatar Financial Research Center, with the Center for Interfaith Dialogue. We are reaching to the grassroots because we believe as well that it's part of our mission to develop the inquiring minds of the young children who are going to be the input to all the programs of research, activity, development in all aspects. And as such, we are collaborating with the Council for Education on developing criteria for Islamic studies, with the schools in training people, young children, on dialogue and principles and values of being critical, inquiring, in the same time, open to the others. We have extended our collaboration to the rest of the world. We can go, it's quite a list I'm proud of, from North America going to Europe to Southeast Asia, are in various research activities. Soon we are going to have a few publications with Copenhagen Universities, with Copenhagen University, others with Ashase Embarrass. And just again, within the time available, I would go on for a longer bit. Soon, thanks for the digitization aspect and dissemination of Islamic culture. And again, we are studying at the moment, and we hope that to start inquiring with our Carnegie Mellon colleagues about Islamic architecture and some of the specific projects so we can disseminate that. We are cooperating with the Golden Web of Cambridge University, again on the same project. And we have working relations with about 15 countries developing and disseminating the modern, the basic concept of Islam as we can see it and conceive it in Europe, in Asia, and in Africa. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dean Karanshawy. I think we cannot conclude that discussion without referring to a very important program that has been created more than 3 years ago, and their first graduates are coming this year, and that is the Media and Communication Program of Northwestern University. As all of us know, Qatar has become, in the last decade, a leader of media, not only in the Arab world, but throughout the whole region and probably in the world. We felt, and we, based on our continuous monitoring of the manpower needs of the whole region, we discovered that there is a clear lack of highly qualified professionals in this very important platform, which allows us to reach not only the region, but the whole world. And we couldn't find a better partner than Northwestern University at Evanston, Chicago, who is offering one of the top-ranked programs of media and communications. And I would like to invite Dean Dennis
Evers Dennis, really, to share with you some of their approaches towards research and education in that particular area.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fathy. Well, it's a privilege to be here, and it's a privilege to be in this region and in Qatar, which, and to be part of one of the most exciting educational partnerships in the world today. And I think you've heard some of that in the sister institutions of Education City, the support of the Qatar Foundation, and the Qatar National Research Fund, all of which work synergistically to make our work go very well. When I was leaving New York City a few months ago to move to Qatar, people asked me why, and today's discussion has given me all the answers that I could have marshaled at that time. My nephew, though, convinced me I should come to Qatar because he said, "Oh, you're going to Qatar?" I said, "Yes." He said, "Qatar is cool." And I said, "Well, depends on how you define cool." But indeed, Qatar is a country of enormous promise and enterprise. And I must say that our work at the Northwestern University in media, communications, and journalism is all about creating a talent bench for a country where the media enterprises are evolving, in a region where the Arab Spring has so defined social media, where there's enormous change. So anything one might think about media and communication these days is in the midst of enormous change. And that change is not only about training personnel and mastering freedom of expression, but it's also about knowledge, and it's about generating new knowledge, and I think navigating the change. And in order to do that, we need a research enterprise that can make that happen. To that end, we are developing a research group that will connect our faculty research and strengthening members of our faculty who are doing research. And we're going to do that along the lines of, on the one hand, synthetic work, which pulls together through consensus conferences and other work, the work of world-class scholars to summarize where we are in the starting point of any number of places that we need to go in order to deal with this disruptive economy of change in the communications field. And secondly, we're doing work on critical events and what is sometimes known as firehouse research, and it's to get into the field to try to take on enterprises as quickly as we can while the action is happening, particularly in a place where there's enormous change. And finally, of course, our original research projects. We have a number of projects now that relate to some of the 2030 initiatives in Qatar to move toward a more knowledge-based economy. One of them has to do, in fact, with childhood obesity and early onset diabetes and the role of communications in dealing with that in terms of various kinds of health interventions. We have some others that have to do more with freedom of expression and the role of media as it evolves. We've even been asked to do something that would be unthinkable almost anywhere else in the world, and that is to help a country in this region that is undergoing amazing change to frame and design its media system. Now, whether that will happen or not, but we can create the kind of Magna Carta or the manifesto to make that happen. How do we do that? Through research. Through research on the governance issues that have to do with media law and regulatory authority that will play into a larger governmental scheme, through the media economy and the development of new business models in a time when everything is changing, through the mastery of technology. We're doing a lot of work on that in terms of how a country in this region might leapfrog various technologies in order to get to a new kind of media system, and indeed through defining what the quality of information and journalism and indeed entertainment content might be as part of another enterprise, and then finally the education and training mission in which we are a part. And we think that's very important. We've been asked to do that with great speed. To do that, to that end, we're involving some of our own people. We're bringing in leading scholars and experts from around the world, and we will sit in what we call a good offices conference, to indeed help a country design its system by uniting research, knowledge through action, and at least to develop a template that might or might not work, depending on all of the other aspects that really are a part of this. In order to make all these kinds of things happen, we need to also be cognizant of the fact that we are trying to embrace both an information and an entertainment culture in a time when the creative content culture of media has been greatly outdistanced by the business and engineering culture. And indeed, where media enterprises have relatively little role in their own leadership, and it's going to require some research and some navigation to that end to address some of those kinds of questions as well. And so this is a great place to do it. And we found that the community here, Dr. Fathy mentioned this being a great media center, Al Jazeera, new media enterprises. We were in the community last night with a leader of the internet, a world leader in the internet field, trying to talk about how that was going to change and impact things. We're doing outreach through the community to connect research and practice as a part of what will be the 2030 plan, and to play our part in helping Qatar achieve a knowledge-based economy, which was the point of the first conversation this morning. So thank you very much for letting me be here as a
part
of this panel.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dennis. I would like actually to conclude this session by saying how grateful I am to the panelists of this group as well as to the other panelists. And I would like also to thank that great audience that has been so patient with us during our elaboration on the research enterprise we have in Qatar. I hope when I said actually that to try to bring all that together is a great challenge, is becoming quite clear now. But I think with the right plans, we are starting to do that. And in this respect, I believe that the Qatar Research Institutes shall continue to play the leading role in that respect, as well as a governance model that has been recently developed and approved by the leadership of the Qatar Foundation. And hopefully, in the very near future, we'll even start thinking about a senior leadership of research and development across the whole of the Qatar National Research Enterprise. Thank you very much, and I hope you will enjoy the more elaborations and the more details you are going to hear from my colleagues, QNRF, QSTP, as well as from our existing partners this afternoon. So thank you very much. Thank you very much.